So the final part of this 19th gene key. Looking forward to this part. The whole teaching of this key, and part of this is rooted in some of the old human design knowledge, which is that in the human design teaching, the 19th gene key represents, and in our body, therefore, in the body, human design body graph, it represents this deep spiritual need to worship something beyond ourselves. And that's what's changing. That's what's changing in our DNA. This is the time that we're, you know, this is the time of the great change, the mutation. And in this 19th gene key, in all humans, this is changing. And because it's changing in humans, it's changing at all levels throughout creation, because you can't have one isolated change or mutation. It doesn't exist. Because everything in the cosmos is interconnected, everything. So a great change, really, it means a great change. It means throughout the chain of the cosmos. You know, so as humans are changing, we are just one small part of the change. So the shift is from worship to embodiment. And this is why our old religions, our tribal religions, based on worship, are declining, are falling away. And this new paradigm, spiritual paradigm, is emerging, all because of this change in this 19th gene key. And the gift here is the gift of sensitivity, and it is this sensitivity to the transdimensional realities. So as we awaken as a species, then we awaken to all these different dimensions and layers, you know, as our new awareness centers, you know, the belly especially, as the solar plexus opens up, as it truly opens up our potential as a species to live a cosmic interdimensional life, you know, because of the shift in our DNA, the shift of our functioning, of our awareness. So this has all kinds of implications. And one of the most beautiful ones, I think, is that because, in a way, our religions began here in this gene key, you know, because they began here, the ancient path of the shamans, you know, the first human religions began in, well, they say in the Tungus people, for example, in Siberia, you know, they say that the first primal religions began there. We don't know, but it's this ancient shamanic way, you know, and the shamanic ways have been kept alive through our indigenous peoples. And we have always looked, you know, in the modern age, we tend to look upon the indigenous belief systems as less evolved intellectually than ours, you know, because of the way they use magical thinking. So they think about, you know, the way that the indigenous people tend to see life and the universe is through a magical lens, you know, and we see that as superstitious. You know, our projection on them is that they have all these superstitions and these rituals and things that we don't, you know, and we've grown and evolved beyond that. That's how we see it. And yet what I find beautiful is that now we get to integrate that, those gifts. We get to honor our ancestors and our indigenous people by integrating their view into the modern holistic transcendent view. You know, so we don't leave it behind. I mean, I'm thinking of, you know, Ken, you might know Ken Wilber's system of integral theory, you know, and what you see is that down at the sort of lower levels of primal religion are this magical thinking and superstition and stuff. But then as you get to the top, near the top, to these teal and turquoise colors and stuff, which represent the higher ways of viewing, higher, you know, interdimensional mind. It's transcend and include. It includes. So this is the beautiful thing, is that we get to include this way of looking at the cosmos that is rooted in the earth, in our ancestors and in the indigenous tribes, even today. We get to integrate that into our new spiritual paradigm. We don't leave it behind and move on to some other view. We integrate it. We transcend and include. And this is so powerful. The people that have done this quite well are the Tibetans, actually. Because the Tibetans, they integrated their Bon tradition, which is a shamanic tradition, into their Buddhist tradition. And so they end up with a very colorful, slightly crazy in a way, tantric Buddhism, version of Buddhism, that's very alive with the, it's filled with all these deities and rituals, and some of them are quite obscure and, you know, they're very colorful. But in the new view, we get to integrate all worldviews, not just the Buddhist, but all, you know, so that includes these ancient traditions. And that's where the 19th gene key comes, really, this transition is really important. I call it the art of magical thinking, because it's to look at the universe through magical eyes. And this is like, this can be easily misunderstood, because there's a distinct difference between fantasy and delusion and magical thinking. Magical thinking is to be able to use the right brain, to be able to use the creative imagination, but to use also the intuition at the same time to guide us. You know, so we think about things, we allow ourselves to think about things like a child thinks about things, but from within an objective view. So we never identify, you know, that was the difference between, you know, the old superstitions, is that you, in the superstitious, in, as it was in the old day, you identified with the object, you know, so you, the magical universe, you identified with it absolutely. And therefore, you became, in a way, entangled with it. But with the new view, you don't identify with it. You use the creative imagination in a magical way, but you integrate that into this higher aspect, knowing that you're none of it. You know, knowing, you know, so you, we draw on the Eastern tradition of the, you know, the unity consciousness, the non-dual perspectives, for example, but we bring in this other component of the right brain, you know, of the magical universe, where we can play, we're more playful. You know, this is a more playful approach. It really absorbs the creative impulse. You know, some of those very pure non-dual traditions, they don't really absorb the creative impulse. They're not creative. You know, they don't, you know, because they come from the Eastern mindset. You know, they're very pure in that sense. But when you bring in the Western mind as well, you have this kind of amazing confluence of all the archetypes that get built into that. So you end up with a completely different spirituality, a rich spirituality that, you know, is playful. So that's what this 19th gene key, I'll give you some examples, right? When you, you know, human beings are just one chain of evolution. We have many parallel evolutions. Now, one of them is the Devic evolution, which I've mentioned already. The Devic evolution is a subtle layers of life force that surrounds all the living creatures and beings on our planet, right? So the plants and the minerals and the animals and the birds and the insects and all those, that is the inner world of the shaman, you know, is to interact with all these things, the crystals, the stones, the elements of the, you know, the stars, everything, you know, for that is the playground of the shaman, you know, the underworld, going into the underworld, down into the psychotropic realm, and then pulling in insights and then weaving it all together, you know, and bringing magic alive. You know, true magic, where the magic is to be able to use the art of correspondences and to be able to see what everything corresponds to, and therefore to gain great illumination through that as a spiritual path. So the 19th really brings this shamanic path alive And but it also propel the shift in it propels us into the into a new kind of spirituality. So the example is, you know, if you take the, you know, the five elements, you have, you know, earth, water, air, fire, and which one is it? Earth, water, air, fire, and ether, right? Ether is the fifth element, the ether. The ether is the transcendent one. And the etheric plane is the plane in which many of these other Devic dimensions live on. So take like elves, right? The notion of elves, the elf, you know, from like from Tolkien, from The Lord of the Rings, right? When you really consider like the people that wrote those books, you know, there are entire languages that people have discovered, you know, or created out of the imagination. And we believe that we've created those. You know, we actually believe, you know, and those wonderful fantasy books that people have read, we believe that we've created those out of our imagination. And that's one way of looking at it. Another way of looking at it is that they already existed. You know, that actually those fantasy novels that have been written, or those fantasy books like The Lord of the Rings and all those names and things and those languages, those, you know, they are the history of the elf realm. And we just, someone has just had that cross species gate that's enabled them, maybe, you know, that gene key, that 19, that's just enabled them to transcribe those things, thinking that that's imagination. And it is. But what if it's actually real? You know, what if fantasy is real, is reality? You know, this is where fantasy and reality come together. That's magical thinking, the art of magical thinking. You see what I mean? Like, it's very subtle, because you mustn't get lost in identification. But what you realize is, like, take the elf world, you know? I can't believe I'm talking about the elf world, but like, there is a parallel evolution to us. And it lives on a subtle dimension. We can't see it, you know, but it's parallel to the human. We can't see them. Not generally. Some people can, and there are times when there's crossovers. You know, this is dictated particularly, you know, by the moon cycles. You know, the moon, as it waxes and wanes, opens and closes portals between the realms, particularly between the human and the Deva realms. Always has done. This is why magic and witchcraft and folklore and Wicca and all those things, you know, they use the knowledge, the secret knowledge, to make the crossing over points, to bring information across. It can be used for all kinds of, you know, highly dodgy ways and subverted, you know, in all kinds of ways. But essentially, there are parallel evolutions, and they exist in different time realms from us. Different time realms, right? So time is key. Like, so those elf beings that we call elves, we kind of see them as elves and we humanize them as elves, right? They are, you know, they exist in a different time than us, right? And their version of time is different from ours. So the elf realm, the Deva realm of nature spirits, for example, of those elemental beings, for them, they are relatively immortal, you know, so they have a different time. You know, human beings, our time span is like, our lifespan is of 100 years or so, is like incredibly quick. But in that realm, lives are incredibly long compared to ours. But they, you know, because, so that, yeah, do you see what I mean? I'm playing in this realm. So you have these legends of elves falling in love with humans and humans falling in love with elves, right? And crossing over. And then this great longing, because the human lifespan is so short and the elf one is so long. So you have great sadness as well, and longing woven between our realms. And all these stories emerge, and these myths and fables emerge because of these crossing over points. And sometimes you get elves or elvic beings or Devic beings that incarnate, half incarnate into humans. So you get humans who are half of them is literally in that other world and half of them is in this world, you know, and you get all these combinations. It's a very rich playground, right? And this is magical thinking. What I'm doing here is magical thinking, right? It's opening up possibilities, you know, boundless possibilities for understanding subtle realms. This is what the 19th gene key does. It understands all the subtle realms, but you have to think in a different way. You have to open up into the realm of fantasy, but you have to realize it's not necessarily fantasy, that fantasy and reality are very interconnected in a way that we cannot yet encompass. In the wider interdimensional mind, there's no original thought. Everything already exists. Everything. You know, our imagination does not invent anything. It already exists. Whatever we think we've invented, it already exists in some other form. But we just bring it down into a human realm. You know, and the level of our genius is how open we are to those things. You know, to that causal plane. You know, to these subtle dimensions. So, you know, particularly when I launch in the coming years this new system, the Dream Arc, which opens up this whole realm of magical thinking so that we can begin to penetrate and pierce these other realms using the power of our creative imagination and bring it alive and bring information across the threshold of these parallel evolutions. You know, we can open up to the old deities and the old gods and the old names and the old places, and it's all about the earth and Gaia, because it's everything, you know, so much in this. It's like, I don't know when to stop. Like, there are places where these portals open and close, these mystical places, ancestral places in the earth. And there are times as well when they open, because it's all about time and place, where the memory is encoded. It's encoded in the stones. It's encoded in place, in sanctuary. You know, there are memories held in certain places in the earth, you know, and they open at certain times. And if we are thinking magically, we can be drawn to those places at those times, and we can unlock some of those secrets, and we can become, you know, non-dual shamans, really. Like, the ultimate spiritual journey is to bring together all these different spiritual modalities and paths. So the purity of the non-dual perspective, of the deep Eastern, you know, paths of Buddhism, you know, of Advaita, those incredible pure paths. And we get to bring in the wealth of the creative imagination. We bring that in. And the two together, they create a new paradigm, a new spiritual realm, you know, which is infinite and in terms of its adventures. And this is why, you know, I've been in my incarnation series, in my rebirth series, in my, you know, reincarnation series, I've been like suggesting that we don't fall for this, you know, almost this, there's a spiritual mistake, you know, there's this error where the incarnation is an error that we've fallen into, and we have to escape, you know, we have to escape the Maya and the illusion, but actually we don't have to escape it, we have to play in it, we have to become awake, and then we get to play in it, you know, becoming awake and then leaving it for some higher dimension, that's not the future path. The future path is to play in it, to explore the realms. That's why we're here, to explore. We are journeyers. We are immortal, eternal voyagers of consciousness. Each soul, each separate soul within the panoply of multiple souls, you know, and we're all one. But we're also creators, you know, we're gods and goddesses. And this is where magical thinking, like from the ancestors, from our indigenous people, suddenly comes alive again within this new framework. And then we can honor them instead of pushing them aside as like, those were the old ways. No, Those old ways are so powerful, but they have to be brought forwards now, you know, and understood and woven into a new paradigm. You know, this is the magic of the 19th gene key. You know, in the city of sacrifices, we have to let go of all the old ways and the new ways, and then bring the whole lot into a new world, a new way of being, where freedom is at the core. It's the freedom to explore. It's the freedom not to have all these, this is how it's got to be spiritually. You know, you've got to keep things pure. You know, you've got to have one lineage only and stay with your lineage, which I respect. And the new way is all lineages, is understanding that all lineages have one source. And like a rainbow, you know, of the rainbow of colors of all the lineages and seeing where they cross-connect and cross-pollinate. This is our playground, to explore that and not to get lost in it. That's going to be the key. That's why we have to do our groundwork. That's why in Gene Keys, I have laid out all the groundwork. You have to deal with your emotional wound. You have to deal with your, you know, your negative thinking, your self-worth issues, all this stuff with the wound and suffering. You have to deal with it all, right? And then you're ready to play in this wider field. You know, then you're ready, but you can't do it otherwise. That's why in the order of how the Gene Keys is coming about, you know, these higher realms, these magical realms come later, after we've done the wound work, the shadow work, you know, because there's a higher path. And, you know, Gaia, you know, the ring of Gaia, this codon ring that contains the 19th gene key, Gaia contains all the secrets, you know, all the hidden secrets, and they're all cracking. You know, they're all opening now. But believe me, you need to do the groundwork before you move. You can move to the higher level so that you don't get fixated on the magical thinking. You know, this is my caution as well, because I've opened up this box, you know, this chest of marvels. And there are many people in the sort of new age that get lost down these corridors of fantasy. And if you haven't done your groundwork in your body, in your health, you know, in your relationships, then you have no business being in these magical realms. No business. And you will just get lost. And you won't unlock the true power. You know, you won't be able to flourish. Your health will always forestall you. You'll find that the wealth and the prosperity doesn't come to you because you haven't done the groundwork. So make sure you do your groundwork. And in Gene Keys, this means do the golden path. Come and voyage into the golden path. In there are all the teachings that you need in order to clear the way in a, so that this magical thinking can be put to use. So the caution is not to be tempted too soon to go into these realms. But also, the invitation is to explore them and play with them. So I leave that with you for the moment. Just the things to contemplate about this magical 19th gene key and how it is going, how it is changing us, and how it will open up new pathways and a whole new spirituality that is filled with adventure and boundless light and possibility. And once again, humanity gets to be a child, an innocent child running through the meadows of life, bounding and exploring and opening up beautiful chests full of treasure. And that the imagination, the creative imagination holds. So it's a gleeful, beautiful time that is coming our way. And make sure you do your groundwork first.